All right, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Howard Fuller, his career includes many years in both public service positions and the field of education. Dr. Fuller is a distinguished professor of education. He's founder director of the Institute for Transformation of Learning at Marquette University in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And I just would like to welcome him to the program. Dr. Fuller, thanks so much for coming on with us, sir.
Oh, thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Yes, sir. So I wanted to have you on. Next week is School Choice Week, and I understand you're going to be in Arkansas. I've got a press release here that Dr. Howard Fuller, Dr. Patrick Wolf, leaders in school choice advocacy and research, will speak at a live debate and discussion of school choice beginning at 6 p.m. Monday. It's in Little Rock, January 22nd at Mosaic Church. What can you tell us about that, sir?
Well, it's a meeting where we hope to deal with the questions and issues that people and concerns that people have about addressing parent choice. Patrick is a well-known and probably one of the best researchers out there on this issue. And so I'm really looking forward to being in Arkansas to talk about this important issue to parents and children who are trying to find the best option for their education.
And that's really what this is about. And, you know, you correct me if I'm wrong, but I mean, school choice to me just means, hey, we can't have this, you know, one size fits all where we kind of protect the institution that education has become. It has to be about the children. And I think more ideas and more experimentation in the realm of education is better than just let's just keep sticking with what we're doing and throw more money at it. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think that may be one part of it, but I want to be really clear. I actually don't like the term school choice. I actually prefer parent choice, because the reason why I got into this battle over 20-some years ago was try to make sure that low-income and working-class parents have some of the options that those of us with money have. And so I'm in this battle because I don't think we should have an America where only people with money have the ability to make some decisions about where is the best place for their children. Mm. And since we don't have a situation where we have cookie-cutter children, we have children who have different needs, different interests, and I believe that we ought to have more than one option for parents to try to find the best place for their children. And again, I do believe that parent choice is widespread in America if you have money. And so I don't think this is an issue about whether or not we should have it. It's an issue of who should be able to take the opportunity to have choice.
Okay, so let's talk about that a little bit, because obviously politics comes into play here. There are many, if we're looking kind of at a right-left spectrum, there are many on the left that advocate, you know, the government does X, Y, and Z to help people who are, you know, on the lower rungs of the socioeconomic ladder. So why, and correct me if I'm wrong, but why does it seem like the left is maybe a little allergic to the concept of parental choice, as you put it?
Well, I think that is interesting because I was there in the beginning when the first voucher bill was passed in Wisconsin. And it's really interesting because it was passed through a Democratic legislature and signed by a Republican governor. In the beginning, this was a bipartisan effort. But over time, it has evolved into an effort where many people who see themselves as Democrats or what you call on the left oppose parent choice because they believe that it is an assault on public education. And I think the reason why people think this is that they have an erroneous understanding about the difference between public education and the system that delivers it. And what I am for is public education. But what I'm also for is a different delivery system that allows us to educate the public. And so I think we have to be clear on the distinction between those two things. Hmm. And so you have people who are, quote, protecting a system, but they're trying to make the moral argument that they're protecting public education, when in reality, they're not protecting public education. They're protecting a particular system that is supposed to deliver public education.
That's a really important distinction. And so I was down, I was in Little Rock last year. It was dark, you know, the General Assembly session, and you know, of course, in Arkansas, we have these massive Republican majorities. We have a supermajority in the House. We have almost a supermajority in the Senate, and we have a Republican governor. And so there was a very, very modest, I know you don't like the term, but school choice bill. We couldn't get it passed. And the reason it didn't get passed is because we had Republicans. And it's a key plank in the Republican Party platform, but we had people that were hearing from their superintendents. In some cases, the superintendents across the state were directly lying about the bill. I've talked to some state reps who said that they even got the superintendents to admit that they didn't really even understand what was going on, and they were just, like you said, basically, you're confirming exactly what I experienced. They're just protecting the system, but they're claiming the moral high ground.
Yeah, you know, I think, and we'll use school choice. I mean, I lost that argument a long time ago.
Okay.
But I think what people have to understand is that an education system, and I was a superintendent, an education system is not just an education system, it is an economic system. And in a lot of the rural areas, for example, in places like Arkansas, even in Wisconsin where I live and other places, a school district is the main employer in some of those communities. And so when you begin to talk about giving parents options to choose and to take those resources elsewhere, you're not only talking about education, you're beginning to impact people's economic reality. And so we have to be real when we get into these debates and not talk about stuff that sounds good at one level but doesn't deal with reality. And so the fact of the matter is, in many places where you have, quote, Republican majorities, you can't get parent choice passed because rural areas in particular, Republicans, will oppose it. So we shouldn't think that this is simply a left-right issue. It actually has both bipartisan support in some places and bipartisan opposition in others.
Hmm. So do you believe that decentralization is key when it comes to some of the issues that affect us or that we're facing when it comes to education? You know, maybe more of a localist approach versus like a top down. See, because I guess, Doctor, we're talking with Dr. Howard Fuller. Sometimes I think that if the bureaucrats had their way, they would replace our teachers with robots just so they could predict and monitor everything that, you know, that they teach specifically and then look at the results and try to, you know, tweak it later. I mean, what do you think about the top-down approach versus the local government approach?
You know what? I think it depends. It depends on who the people are. It depends upon what the objectives are. You know what I mean? The one thing I've learned about America and over all of these years, and I do love this country, it's a very interesting country, is that when we begin to talk about this one thing is the way to do it as opposed to this one thing, it's almost never come to pass. So I look at it and say, in certain situations, you want to make sure that the people at the base, the people who are being impacted, that they have a lot to say about what happens. But in other instances, you want that also to be working in concert with people who may be running a particular bureaucracy and so forth. So having been a superintendent, I always believed that the only way I could really make change was to have people power at the base. You know what I mean? Because when you're the head of a bureaucracy, if you care about what's really happening to the people that you're serving, you want those people to have as much power as possible to even push against you. Because I needed people to be empowered, because if you don't have power in the base, you're usually strangled by the middle. And so that if you're on top of something and you really want change to occur, you want to make sure that the people who are being affected have the most power, even if they're going to come out in opposition to you. Because that's just how I see things. I don't think we should depend on bureaucracy to serve the people, but we need the help of bureaucracies to serve the people. The question is, how do you empower the people so that they can make sure that they're being served well?
Hmm. Yeah, that's really, really good. Those are really, really noble goals. So again, folks, we're talking with Dr. Howard Fuller. I mean, he has an extensive career in this education field. He definitely knows what he's talking about. So last question, and I know this is just a general question, but parent choice. Okay. What do you think the one thing that we could do legally or legislatively that would get us the best results and give parents more choice?
I think, there are a variety of ways of doing it, because parent choice is a broad umbrella. And under that umbrella, you can have a variety of different policies. So, for example, in Milwaukee, we have a voucher program that allows people who are, I think it's 300% of poverty, to access private schools. You also have like a thing called open enrollment, where people can access any school district in the state. Within the school district, you also have the ability of people to choose different types of schools for their children. So what I think we have to do, Paul, is not see parent choice as one particular, you got to do it this one particular way. The question is, in a given community, what would be the best way to make sure that parents have a variety of options? Let's say you're in a rural area where you only have 200 kids in a school district. I mean, there are these very, very small school districts. So the question would be, in a school district like that, what would be the best way to make sure that parents had an option, and you also were going to have the resources that you could provide the best education for the children? What it could mean is a radically new design for the existing district, so that the choices that people are talking about may primarily take place within the context of that district. Whereas in other places, you want to make sure that people have access to private schools because you have a robust private school structure within those areas. So I think the problem comes, those of us who fight for parent choice can't only have one way of even trying to approach parent choice, so that we can't be like the thing that we're fighting, where we keep saying, well, there's only one way to do this. No, there's got to be a variety of different ways to do it to empower parents. We just have to open up our minds to be creative to make that happen.
Yeah, that's really, really good stuff, Dr. Howard Fuller. I appreciate you coming on, and I definitely know the parents across Arkansas, I think what you're saying definitely resonates with them, because parents want more choices when it comes to their kids' education. And I just want to say welcome to Arkansas, even though you're not here yet, but you're gonna be in Arkansas Monday, January the 22nd at Mosaic Church, 6 p.m. in Little Rock. Dr. Howard Fuller and Dr. Patrick Wolf, you guys are going to be having a debate. About 200 people are expected to attend. Folks, show up. You just heard him here. Dr. Fuller, I appreciate you coming on the program. It's been my pleasure, sir.
Thanks for having me.
All righty, folks. We got to take a break. Don't go anywhere.